say I'm disturbed.
Of course I'm disturbed.
Working in this warehouse, and we'd all gather in this little break room, and I'm telling my jokes to all the guys, and I'm prepping for my open mics are coming up. And one day the foreman comes in, and he finally looks at me and he says, "You know what? You just shut up. You don't think we all had dreams? Hey, guess what? You're gonna end up staying here like the rest of us. So just shut up, get back on your high low, and let's get to work." And I remember I got on my high low and I sat there for 20 minutes, mm-hmm. and I just thought, this is the moment where someone just hit me in the head with a hammer. This is the universe telling me, wake up now. I said, "I quit." And he goes, "You can't quit. You know what? I can do anything I want. Thank you for telling me that, because if I don't leave today, I'll never leave." And I left that night, basically drained my bank account, trying to like be a comedian. Yeah. But eventually I found my spot. Comedy mm-hmm. started to blow up. And next thing I knew, I started touring around the country wow. and making a living being a comic.
It doesn't matter where you're at or who you're around. The minute you tell people you're a comedian, the first thing they want to know is, so who is your influences? Who made you want to be the kind of comedian that you've become today? For me, the first great influence I had was Richard Pryor. Pryor was not just a comic, but he was one of the greatest storytellers that ever lived. The first time I saw a Richard Pryor bit that really changed me, did a bit about being in Chicago and how Chicago was so cold that when you left a club, the wind would be waiting for you. And he actually became the wind.
You go outside, the wind be waiting on your ass around the corner like this, me. Waiting for you to come outside. You know what?
Here you come.
And that shit, boy. I came from California. I hadn't been home about 5 years. And I went back home and I had some shit like this, you know. And it was cold. That wind waited for me to get into the street. It didn't even do nothing while I was walking through the airport. As soon as I got outside, it went like, "Get your shit. Put that shit up around your head."
I'd never seen anything like that before. Up until that moment, I had only seen comics do this, you know, set up punchline jokes. I never saw someone ever become the wind. I had never imagined that you could make something like the wind into a character. Man, Richard Pryor was the greatest storyteller to ever live. And one of the reasons why I fell in love with Chicago. And Chicago is where I got to see my next comic influence. I was working at a club called Zany's. It was so exciting. And there was a club that wasn't far away called the Funny Firm. The headliner for that week was Bill Hicks. I couldn't wait to finish my sets and get my butt down to the Funny Firm to watch Bill Hicks. See, what people don't remember about Bill Hicks, if you weren't living through that experience, is that Bill wasn't a traditional comic the way comics were back then. I mean, most comics back then were still wearing sports jackets and had their sleeves rolled up. Bill was doing all the things that everybody else wasn't doing. He had embraced people like Lenny Bruce and Carlin, philosophers and other influences that he had brought to
stage. I ride at
an
amusement park, and when you choose to go on it, you think it's real because that's how powerful our minds are. And the ride goes up and down and round. It has thrills and chills, and it's very brightly colored, and it's very loud, and it's fun for a while. Some people have been on the ride for a long time, and they begin to question, is this real or is this just a ride? And other people have remembered, and they come back to us and they say, "Hey, don't worry, don't be afraid, ever, because this is just a ride." And we kill those people.
Shut him up. We have a lot invested in this ride. Shut him up. Look at my furrows of worry. Look at my big bank account and my family. This has to be real. It's just a ride. But we always kill those good guys who try and tell us that. You ever notice that? And let the demons run amok? But it doesn't matter, because it's just a ride. And we can change it anytime we want. It's only a choice. No effort, no work, no job, no savings of money. A choice right now between fear and love. The eyes of fear want you to put bigger locks on your door, buy guns, close yourself off. The eyes of love instead see all of us as one. Here's what we can do to change the world right now to a better ride.
Take all that money we spend on weapons and defense each year and instead spend it feeding, clothing, and educating the poor of the world, which it would many times over, not one human being excluded, and we can explore space together, both inner and outer, forever in peace.
So if you think Bill Hicks is making quite an impression on you now, well, he made quite an impression to all of us who have been able to see his legacy grow. It just goes to show that being a great provocateur and a troublemaker, standing up against the status quo, sometimes makes you the least liked guy in the room, but over time, makes you into a legend. I'm Kirk Nolan. Thanks for tuning in. I'll see you next time on the flip side.